All right, bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa ahlul uqdata min lisani yafqahu qawli. All right, bismillah. You guys ready for the next session, inshallah? Where do we stop? We start something unique. The dead body. May Allah bless you and protect you. Say ameen. Bani Israel, along with Musa alayhi salam, carrying a dead body. What's the story? Let's go thousands of years later, after Musa alayhi salam, let Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tell us what was going on. Ready, inshallah? One time, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sallallahu, he was passing by an Arabi, a villager, humble person, you know, not very fancy house, not very fancy, you know, furniture and so on. This Arabi hosted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you have to really pause for a moment and see the humbleness of your Prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he didn't mind an invite from a very poor person. Right? He didn't say, oh, where do you live? What city? Oh, you live there? No, you come to my place. Right? Unless about safety is of serious concern, that's understandable, yeah. For my point being is that he accepted the invite, he walked into the house of that villager, and that villager, فَأَكْرَمَهُ, he honored Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning honored the guest, of course. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told this Arabi, this villager, after they were done, he told him, اِئْتِنَا, next time you come to my place. I wanna give back, right? You invited me one day, next day I wanna invite you back. And this also to appreciate your Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said, مَنْ أَتَى إِلَيْكُمْ بِمَعْرُوفٍ فَكَافِئُهُ. He says, whoever does good to you, reciprocate. Someone invited you for lunch, it's sunnah to invite them back. For example, for lunch, for dinner, for another meal. Give and take, they gifted you a gift, give them a gift one on some other day. That's the way of Islam. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you cannot give something similar back, then pray for that person until you feel you returned the favor back. Give me an example. Sometimes people may gift you something or invite you to a very fancy restaurant, the Highlands. Okay, all the way up to the GM, 75th floor or something. The halal steak, by the way, one of them is actual Islamic dhabiha, the real deal. So you have to pay $75. Anyways, bismillah. So you go there, someone invites you, and then you're like, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, you gotta reciprocate. I'm not paying $75. So you make dua for them. He says, فَدْعُوا لَهُ حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا أَن قَدْ كَافَأْتُمُوهُ. So pray for that person until you feel you can return back the favor. So the bigger the favor, the more what dua that you make. So he told them, next time you come over. And indeed, the Arabi took the invite right away. Another day passed by or two, Allah knows best. The Arabi comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's house. When he comes, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam honored him, honored the guest. After the meeting was almost being concluded or so, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad, he tells the Arabi, the villager, sal hajatak, make a wish. You have any request, anything you wish to have, anything you dream to accomplish, what do you wish? Ya Allah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is asking you, do you have any wishes? Do you have any wish, like a dream that you want to make it happen? What would you guys ask for? Huh? What would you ask for? Yes, please. Please have Allah pay off all my student loan. Right? Yeah, have Allah pay off my mortgage. Right? Oh, is it halal haram? Now you guys like the halal haram stuff. I know you guys. When I say halal haram stuff, you're like, everybody's like, yeah, this is a real deal. Not like stories and stuff. La, stories is respectful, beautiful, where we learn from it. May Allah honor all of us, Ya Rabbi Al-Alameen, and take them serious, Ya Rabbi. So, what would you guys ask for? Think. This man, he told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, naqa, I want a camel. At that time, a camel was a real big deal, like an S-Class Mercedes, yani S500, something like that, very fancy stuff, a camel. Then he said, وَأَعْنُزٌ يَحْلُبُهَا أَهْلِي, and I want some goats, you know, multiple ones that my family can milk. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he uses this opportunity to share a piece of advice. Not just to the villager, but the Sahaba, the companions around. And he said, أَعَجِزْتُمْ أَن تَكُونُوا مِثْلَ عَجُوزِ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. Were you guys not able to be like the old lady from the children of Israel? So the Sahaba said, and who is that old lady from the children of Israel? That's a way of teaching people, right? Asking a question, cliffhangers, and so on. So he said, let me tell you. Musa alayhi salam, the story now of the dead body that I told you about, remember? Musa alayhi salam, when Allah commanded him and the children of Israel to escape and leave Egypt, they left during the day or night? Huh? Day or night? فَأَسْرِي بِعِبَادِي لَيْلًا, at night time. So while they're trying to escape as quietly as possible, ضَلُّوا الطَّرِيق, they lost their way. So they're like, oh, what, go right, left, oh my God, we need to know what to do. The scholars of the Bani Israel told Musa why they think they lost the way. طَبْ يَخِي, speak up. And he waited for us to lose the way, then you speak up. May Allah protect us. Inna Yusuf alayhi salam, Prophet Yusuf. What does Prophet Yusuf have to do with this? Prophet Yusuf, about 400 years ago, okay, what about him? When he was on his deathbed, Yusuf alayhi salam, tell me something special about him. Something special? Something special about him and his lineage. Go ahead. Ahsant, excellent. His father was a prophet whose name is Yaqub. Yusuf's father's name is also Israel. That's Yusuf's dad's name. Israel and also what? Yaqub. Interchangeable. Okay? So Yusuf is what? Bani, child of Israel. So the first child of Israel to ever go to Egypt was who? Yusuf. Fantastic. When he was dying, he told the people around him from Bani Israel that moved from Philistine or Al-Ard Al-Muqaddasa. He told them, if you guys ever leave Egypt, Misra, take my body from the ground. So I will die very likely here and get buried in Egypt. So if you guys end up leaving Egypt, come to my grave, dig my grave, take my body and leave. I don't want to stay behind here when all of you are leaving. Authentic, authentic hadith. Okay, so Musa alayhi salam said, okay, and where is the grave? The scholar said, no one knows except the old lady, Ajuz Bani Israel. So Musa alayhi salam, let's go. فَأَمَرَ بِهَا أَن تَأْتِي. He asked for her to come. فَأَتَتْ. Then she showed up, she came. So he told her, you know, where is the grave of Prophet Yusuf? He said, yes. Dullini alay, tell me, where is it at? She said, but I have a request first. I have a condition. Allahu Akbar. She's a genius. He could have told her that, and I don't take no conditions. He opened the door. Okay, what's your wish? So it's basically she's saying, you want me to tell you where the grave is at? You want me to give you something? You gotta give me something. Business. Allahu Akbar. So he told her, وَمَا حُكْمُكِ وَمَا سُؤْلُكِ. Okay, what is it, your request? What's your wish? What do you want for us to provide so you can tell us where is the body of Prophet Yusuf? Because you have to realize something. There's a connection between them losing the way and not finding the grave of Yusuf. Why? Because Bani Israel disobeyed the command of the Prophet Yusuf. Right? Whether knowingly or unknowingly, Allah Ta'ala, it was not fulfilled. So because when we do not fulfill the commands of the prophets, we lose our way as well. You see that? And that's not a strike against Musa. The leader is amazing. But sometimes the followers are the reason why we're not moving ahead. Okay, tell me where the grave of Yusuf alayhi salam is. She said, حَتَّى تَأْتِيَنِي سُؤْلِي. Okay, what do you want? What do you want in return? What did she ask? The whole story. Rasulullah is telling his sahaba, because the difference between this villager who had the opportunity to make a wish, right? What did he ask for? A camel and some goats. He's now going to compare and how to really utilize this opportunity by someone from another nation, Bani Israel. This old lady told Musa, my request is for me to be your neighbor in paradise. Musa alayhi salam, he's like, whoa. فكره أن يعطيها ذلك. يعني he didn't feel excited, or he didn't feel like, oh yeah, sure, I got you. Ya Rabbi, he didn't feel moved. He was impressed, but he's like, I don't feel like I have a good reason to go to God. Like, ya Allah, this lady, make her with me or my partner in paradise or with the prophets in general because of a piece of information she did or she gave us. You see what I'm saying? Like, you know, when like someone says, hey bro, your dad is a CEO of Microsoft. Okay, so let him hire me. طيب يا أخي, do me a resume. Let me do something significant so I can go to my father, the CEO of Microsoft, to go tell him, hire this my friend right here. Like, do something, you know, powerful, move me. But in the eyes of Musa, and he's a human being, alayhi salam, he didn't feel like it's something that warrants her to reach this level because of a piece of information she had due to her old age and someone passing it down. It's not a lot of struggle and effort. People go to heaven with the prophet because they gave up their lives right in the battlefield. People gave up their wealth. People went to Hajj and did this and guided hundreds of thousands of people. Then they might reach the point of being neighbors with the prophets. You want to give it to me because he's going to say, it's here? Zakariya is like, it's tough. فَأَوْحَى اللَّهُ إِلَى مُوسَى. Allah revealed to Musa, أَعْطِهَا سُؤْلَهَا. Tell her her wish will be granted. Allahu Akbar. طبعا صحابة, why? Allah sees that she deserves it. Because she just showed she had high ambitions. And the first opportunity she had to make sure she reaches that level of ambitions, to be in paradise, she utilized it. Many of us have goals, agreed? I wanna do this, and I'm gonna, you know what, I don't mind working in a restaurant. I know I'm not finding my engineering job. I don't mind doing, you know, shawarma sandwiches. I have no problem. Oh, by the way, I work in a restaurant and I actually was hiring. Tafaddal. I wasn't serious, like, you know, I was looking a little bit exaggerating. صح? You have ambition, I wanna go to Jannah. Wallahi, the first opportunity to give da'wah, the moment you open up a Quran memorization class, I'll register. We have one, inshallah, coming up next year. Wallahi, brother, like, I don't know what to tell you. Right? So this lady, she always had this ambition, Jannah, 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 and she worked, and she tried, and she tried. She has a moment to complete that, get the blue check, verified, I'll be at Jannah by a prophet. I asked for it, so Allah says, she deserves it. Tell her that she deserves it. And this is an example to have high ambitions. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be similar to this old lady from Bani Israel. The Prophet is choosing her to be a role model to the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een. And you got to learn from that and appreciate that. And there's a wonderful group of examples. There is an example of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. One time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, those who donate will be called on the Day of Judgment from one of the gates of paradise. So paradise has what? Multiple abwab, multiple gates. There are gates that are special for certain qualities that you excel above average at, and Allah knows best how He grades it. So there are certain doors for those who donate a lot. They'll be called. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there's another door, babul jihad, those who fight in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they'll be called from it. And there's another door called babul rayyan. That door is going to be called to the ones who fast very often. So he's saying this, this, and that. So then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, what do some people may say today, mathalan? Wallah, my ambition is just not to go to hell. If I don't go to hell, I made it. Right? Others a little bit above, they say, bro, as long as it's like, you know, if I'm one foot in Jannah, one foot outside, I'm good, right? What kind of ambition is this? Sahih? So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he tells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is it possible for one person to be called from every gate? Ya Allah, ya feel the energy. May Allah grant us such energy. Ya Rab, Ya Rasulullah, is there a person that his name will be called from every gate? Right? Like, you know what happens in high school, college, universities? The one with the best, for example, I'm simplifying, the one with the highest grade, 4.4 GPA, Ahmed, Yusuf, Khalid, Takbir, Allahu Akbar. The one, now the announcement for the second prize, the one with the best manners in school, Ahmed, Yusuf, Khalid, yes. And the one that, Ishfi Ashya, awards, subhanAllah, may Allah forgive us, right? Awards, yani awards, what is it? good citizen, right? Ahmed, Yusuf, Khalid. So before Ahmed, Yusuf, Khalid got all of these, he heard there are all these awards. So he went to his professor. He said, "Professor, how can I be the best student, the best one, best character? How can I do this? How can I do that? How can I volunteer? I want to get them all." Can you imagine a student going to the professor doing this? Some people actually may go that far, right? When I apply for every scholarship in the world, can I get all the scholarships and actually get cash? Right? That's how much money I got scholarship. That's how people in dunya do. But Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, full ambition, ali, high. Can someone be called from all the doors in Jannah? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Na'am wa arju an takuna minhum," and I hope you'll be one of them. Meaning you will be one of them, ya Abu Bakr. Respect Abu Bakr radiallahu an, the greatest Sahabi ever walked on earth. Don't you dare compare him to Umar ibn al-Khattab. Even Umar will be angry at you. Even Umar will be angry at you. Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he said, "Layla min layali Abu Bakr." One night of Abu Bakr, one night is better than all of the life of Umar. What night is that? What one night of Abu Bakr Siddiq outweighs his value? All the Sahaba, one night. What night is he talking about? The night he spent in the cave with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all alone. Allahu Akbar. And may Allah be pleased by all the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. So Abu Bakr Siddiq saying this, and you have to be very ambitious. There's one time a teenager did not exceed 15 years old. He was presenting water to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to make wudu from. He used to love to be in the service of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So one time Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam really appreciated that, you know, service and providing water to make wudu. So then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told this young man, "Sal, make a wish." Raja'na naf, same almost concept. Did not reach 15 years old and Allah knows best. Make a wish. What would that young teenager ask Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for? He said, "Murafaqataka fil Jannah." For me to be with you in Jannah. For me to walk next to you on the day of judgment. For me to be with you, your neighbor, the next door house with you in Jannah. Ya Rasulullah. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Awa ghayri shayin ghayra thalik," anything else besides this? He said, "Huwa thak," this and only that. Allahu Akbar. This and only that. That's my ambition in life, to be your partner in Jannah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he appreciated that ambition. And he's showing him hope that inshallah you will be, but you have to take action. Having goals alone and having so many dreams of it will not get you there as much as how hard you work towards it. So he tells him one action item, the greatest of action items that will make you my neighbor in Jannah. فَأَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ. Pray as much as you can. Salah. You do fajr, do the sunnah before fajr. You do dhuhr, do two or four before, and then two after. Maghrib, do two after. Isha, do two after. Witr, the last rak'ah, do it. Brother, I don't know these terms. Note it down. So you can increase your chances to be the neighbor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ask. You make wudu, do two rak'ahs for it. You made a sin. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever commits a sin makes proper wudu. Well, excellent job. Then prays two rak'at, seeking the forgiveness of Allah, except that Allah will forgive their sins. Yalla, salli wa salli wa salli. May Allah make you the neighbor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Musa alayhi salam told her, "We'll grant it to you." Allah says, "You're good to go." Now, where is the grave? So now she pointed, she walked and she pointed. Yusuf alayhi salam is right here. But where did she point? It was like a pond, like a buhayra, filled with water. Maybe it's rain. Allahu alam, how was it filled? So she told them, "Empty all the water out from this pond. Empty it all out." And they threw it all out. They got buckets, a lot of work, and they removed the water. Then she said, "Uhfuru," start digging. Fahafaru, then they found who? The body of Yusuf alayhi salam. Then Musa alayhi salam and the Bani Israel carried the body of Yusuf alayhi salam, and right then and there, what happened? What happened when they got the body? Okay, what happened before they found the body? What happened? They ahsan, who said that? May Allah bless you and protect you and never get you lost. Say ameen. And may Allah grant light through your path till the day you meet Allah. They were lost. And then Allah granted them light, كَأَنَّهُ النَّهَارِ, as if it's the day. It's night, but Allah showed them light as if it was the day. And this is what happens when you follow the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah yunawwir tariqak. Allah will grant you light wa nur upon nur. May Allah grant it to all of us. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. She was a sweet, wonderful lady. You agree? Wonderful lady. We learn from her, inshallah. Bani Israel had wonderful people like this lady. Bani Israel had wonderful people like Musa alayhi salam. But they also had some bad people. But they also had some very, very, very evil people. Extremely evil. So evil. Bro, Fir'aun died. Yeah. But now there's a Fir'aun from within Bani Israel. This evil individual is none other than Shaytan. Ahsan, good point. May Allah protect you from Shaytan. The evil man that Allah has a page and a quarter approximately about this man for you all and myself to learn from. This evil man from Bani Israel, who was a relative to Musa alayhi salam, as many historians said. He is?
A Samiri.
Excellent. Very, very, very close. Actually, you're very much right, honestly. That will be, we'll discuss it later. Someone said the name. Qarun. Allah says, Inna Qaruna kana min qawmi Musa. Qarun was from the people of Musa alayhi salam. Some said that he was actually a believer at one point, but things changed throughout his life. Why? What happened? Oh man, he was so rich. He had so much money. I don't know if anyone of Bani Israel was ever as rich as Qarun. And فَبَغَى عَلَيْهِمْ. He was so evil. He became so arrogant. He was a show-off, boastful, brags. He walks and doesn't care about people's feelings. He wants people to see him. He sees that my value is determined by the people, so I have to do everything possible to impress you. By the way I talk, by the way I dress, by the way I move, everything. He's obsessed. And he will do whatever is necessary, and he will use his money and treasures to stop people of righteousness. And he went berserk like crazy to the extent that now he went against his own cousin and relative, Musa alayhi salam. That he is willing to create a scheme or a plot against Musa alayhi salam. So much so that in some books, it's not from the Quran or the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallam, but from the tafsir, they narrate that Qarun went as far as to shut the ones who say the truth as much as he can, that he sent a baghi, a woman of a very disrespectful, filthy occupation. May Allah protect us all, Amir Rabbil Alameen. Selling what Allah has blessed her with. So then Qarun paid her a lot of money. He told her, you go to Musa when he's around people, and I want you to yell out loud, Musa, remember what you did to me? 1, 2, and 3. And the elders can catch, obviously, what I'm referring to. You did this and he did this. Remember, we were alone, whatever the case was. Musa alayhi salam was in distress. Like, this is not something simple, especially when it's a false accusation, especially when it's towards someone who's very well respected in the community and the whole nation of Bani Israel. So he went and he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking Allah's help and assistance. How do we deal with this? Everybody listened to what this lady said. So then he went to her and he told her, As'aluki billadhi fataha al-bahr. I ask you by the one who split the ocean. I ask you by the one who saved you from Pharaoh. I ask you by the one who created the heavens and the earth. I ask you by Allah. He magnified Allah in her eyes as much as he can to shake her and move her, that she will say God's name for the following question. Who told you to do this? What made you say this about me? Say the truth. Intuqi, takallami. She said, you shook me. The way you worded things about Allah, I'm going to say the truth. Wa astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayh. I got paid by Qarun to take you down. May Allah protect us. Ya Rabbi ya akhi. Wallah, the money sometimes can go into the head. The fame can go into the head. The position and status can go into the head that it messes up people. May Allah protect us. Ya Rabbil Alameen. فَبَغَى عَلَيْهِمْ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, to express to you how rich he was. He was so well off. He was so rich that Allah did not explain to you how much money he had. He kind of told you how many credit cards and debit cards and cash he has. Allah said the keys to his vaults, to his safe, were so many that it required about 10 muscular men to carry the keys. Then what about behind the keys, behind the locks? What did he have? And that's cash. These are not buildings. I'm not talking. We didn't even start yet. That's how rich he was. But then you may ask, did people give him advice? Did people talk to Qarun? Yes, they did. And they gave 5 timeless pieces of advice. May Allah make me and all of you take lesson from it. Say ameen. Powerful. Loved it. I pray to Allah, Ya Rab, bless everyone here and elevate your ranks in this life and the afterlife, because you guys are the means for me to learn it deeper than what I typically know about this topic. So jazakumullah khair. Genuinely, thank you all. Barakallahu feekum for allowing me to learn more about Allah and the Quran. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Jazakumullah khair. So when Qarun was doing all of this, he had his people who've known him. You know, I know where you came from. I know what city you used to live in. I know you're now in West Bloomfield. Okay, I know where you were born, what hospital, where city, whatever the case may be. May Allah bless you all and bless all West Bloomfield citizens. Say ameen. Nothing against you. We had one uncle come last time from West Bloomfield. May Allah grant him Jannah. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Drove with his family. If you're here, may Allah bless you. Dunya wa akhirah. Say ameen. So these people, they know Qarun. You know, we were together in school, you know, and now you're a big shot. Khalas, you know, don't talk to us. But they gave him advice. Yalla, bismillah. Number one, they told him, La tafrah. La tafrah. What is la tafrah? Don't be happy. That's in simple Arabic, right? Don't be happy. La. La tafrah, meaning don't have your life be all about dunya. Don't let your source of joy only be this life. So if you don't take something that is materialistic, you're depressed and you're sad. And if you take it in this worldly life, you're happy and enjoyment. Don't let your entire life be revolving around this life. La tafrah. Don't let every day be a vacation day. You cannot live a life like that, ya Qarun. Can we take vacation day every day? No. You have 2 weeks, 3 weeks vacation days. Okay. You cannot be playing games every single moment, every single day. And the moment you're done with the games, you go watch a movie. And once you're done the movie, you want to go have dinner. And once you have dinner, you don't want to sleep. You want to do something else. Don't be obsessed that you always have to do something that is fun, especially if it's wrong. How many of us, not necessarily little kids, we just come, for example, from Florida, had a wonderful week of vacation. Right when we land, Baba, I'm bored. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. 1 week in Orlando, and this guy, Mickey Mouse, and we paid hundreds of dollars and thousands, and now we didn't even arrive yet. Not every day is vacation, Habibi. Not every day. Life is much bigger than just dunya and cars and money and fame and status. You gotta work. Yes, have fun. La tafrah, though. La tafrah. There's something in positive psychology I learned. It's called hedonic treadmill. What's the hedonic treadmill? People, whenever they do something that is so much fun, after a certain period of time, it's no longer as much fun. Fair enough? Makes sense? You know, I want ice cream so bad. You're desperate for ice cream. You cry, you want ice cream. Khalas, relax. You go to some really good ice cream store. You get 3 scoops of ice cream. May Allah forgive you. I think it's way too much. You take the first scoop. You enjoy it. Second scoop, you're like, eh. Third scoop, you're like, oh Allah, I'm done. I don't want no more. SubhanAllah. So the enjoyment drops, right? So what do people do sometimes? They give you 2 options. Something called endless novelty. Some psychologists, they say to be able to always be happy, 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 is the moment you're feeling it's dropping, do something else that will bring up the hype back up, like excitement, which is not really realistic, but that's how Qarun was. You know what? I'm not having as much fun. Okay, let me do this thing else. Okay, now this is fun. Then a few hours later, I want to do this thing else. Crazy, right? May Allah protect us, Ya Rabbal Alameen. And sometimes we suffer from it, right? You go from one video, you watch this video, okay, then you go, and TikTok knew it. 15 seconds, that's all what you got, right? Do something crazy in 15 seconds. And now they're being generous, and I don't know, say Jazakallah khair, well, I don't know what to do with them, right? Now they make it 3 minutes, and now they're coming up with 5 minutes. But my point being is that this rush, I only got 30 minutes to make it exciting. And then you go next one, next one, next one. Why do you think we spend too much time? Because the moment, if it was a 7 minute Brother Majed reminder, and haddak, 3.5 minutes, you shut it down. And I'm with you, by the way, I feel you sometimes, right? Okay, I just heard it in person, I know it better, no problem, right? But if there's some guy, silly, Mish'arif, he's driving a car, and then all of a sudden he does this, then he's now in an airplane, right? May Allah forgive you, all those who know what I'm referring to, right? So things of that sort, and he's like excited, okay, what did the other person do? What did the other person do? SubhanAllah, and they know exactly how the human being functions. May Allah protect us. So they told Qarun, don't do that. Inna Allah la yuhibbul farihin. Allah doesn't like people with such attitude. Let me give you one hadith here. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever is obsessed about this life, dunya, dunya, dunya is everything for you. Man kanat ad-dunya hammah, ja'ala Allahu faqrahu bayna 'aynayhi. Allah will make poverty between your eyes. Imagine there's a plate that says you are poor here. Okay? Or like, you know how sometimes, may Allah bless you all, but like a donkey, they put a carrot so that donkey can keep going. Right? Whatever. Just, and there's, why the carrot is not coming? I went all the way to another country, but the carrot, there's a stick. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the best of examples, whoever dunya is your main concern, you will see poverty always. No matter what you do, no matter what you get, you're never happy. May Allah not make us of those people. جَعَلَ اللَّهُ فَقْرَهُ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ وَفَرَّقَ عَلَيْهِ شَمْلَهُ. And Allah will disorganize your affairs in life. You'll be lost. Here, whether this phone, whether to do this, whether to travel here. فَرَّقَ عَلَيْهِ شَمْلَهُ وَلَمْ يُؤْتِيهِ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَهُ. And only what Allah has written for you from this dunya is what you will get. And you're running around. Yes, we have to work, I understand. But within reason. So that's the first advice. Don't show off. Don't be obsessed about this life. طبعاً they said it a lot better than me in a very eloquent way, in the appropriate way. Number two, وَبِتَغِي فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Be wise with the blessings Allah has given you. Allah has given you blessings. Use them to increase your account on the Day of Judgment. So whatever Allah has given you, make sure your focus is like, how can I use my talent to get me a house in Jannah? Right? How can I use the blessing Allah has given me to have a beautiful family in Jannah? How can I use the talent and the blessing Allah has given me to be the neighbor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Let that be your goal. Okay? Focus on that, Qarun. Do something about it, Qarun. Use Allah's blessings to avoid being bankrupt in Akhirah. Right? We start to business serious. Not to be bankrupt, I understand. But try not to be bankrupt in Akhirah. Then the other hadith, the opposite of what I told you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this will be a transition to our third point. مَنْ كَانَتِ الْآخِرَةُ هَمَّهُ. Whoever the afterlife was their main concern. Allah radi wa lamish radi. Is Allah happy with me or is Allah not happy with me? Am I going to go to Jannah? You're concerned about Akhirah. I want to do everything to go to Jannah. I want to do everything to be avoiding to hellfire. That's your concern. The three things come again. But in a different way. Poverty was here. Remember the carrot? Now the Prophet says, جَعَلَ اللَّهُ غِنَاهُ فِي قَلْبِهِ. Allah will make the wealth and the richness in your heart. You can never get robbed. Allahu Akbar. It's here. You will always be rich. No matter who is around, no matter what you see in the dunya, you will always feel rich, even if you can barely have an income or barely have money, just have a very simple car, very simple house, you will be rich from the inside. May Allah make us rich from the inside, Ya Rab, and outside. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً. We want the best of both worlds, right? وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And protect us from hell. So the Prophet says, Allah will make wealth in your heart. Number two, وَجَمَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ شَمْلَهُ. When you do what Allah told you to do, you will see your life organized. Murattab. Tartib. You do what Allah told you to do. You think going to Dhuhr or to Asr or praying will ruin your schedule? La, you're wrong. You think that you spending some time and giving your zakah, obligatory charity, will cause you to lose money? No, that's incorrect. The Prophet told you, do what Allah told you to do and your life will be organized. May Allah protect us and organize our lives. Ya Rab. With our families, our kids. Just follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rules. And the last thing, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if akhirah is your main concern, dunya, the worldly life, will be dragged to you. Ya Allah, look at this beautiful wording. تُجَرُّ إِلَيْهِ جَرُّ أَتَتْهُ وَهِيَ رَاغِمَةً Dunya, come here to this man who doesn't want you. Ya Allah. And people are like running after dunya. It's going to come right to you. Just do a little bit of work, inshallah. Allah's barakat coming your way. May Allah protect us. Ya Rabbal Alameen. طيب. I know these gatherings. Focus on akhirah. How to build a house in Jannah. I know you Muslims are boring. You even have a hard time deciding where to go for a honeymoon because everything's haram, haram, haram. Subhanallah. Akhirah. Udunya. We have fun. There's no religion more balanced than Islam. Number three, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Allah is saying in the Quran, the third advice, yes, focus on akhirah, but also enjoy your life. It's okay. Have fun. There's nothing wrong with buying a Ferrari. He just said the Christmas tree. Yahi, don't mix things together. May Allah protect us. Right? I remember one time I was in a convention and I was saying something along these lines. Like someone wants to pay, but guys, relax, saying don't take things out of context. Like someone watching this video cut this and cut that and shows me like a munafiq or something. May Allah protect us. Right? I was in a convention, so we spoke. I think the example was about a wedding. Brother, what do you think is the appropriate amount of money to spend on a wedding? Allahu a'lam. I don't know the exact يعني, measurement. But depending on your capacity. So I think the number, Allah Ta'ala alam, don't exactly remember the actual number. But let's say if someone spends $100,000 on a wedding, is that haram? What do you guys think? No, mashallah, look at the baller status right there. And pocket change, right? So we learn from our mashayikh, as Sheikh Walid Bastuni, he taught us, is that obviously from the Quran and Sunnah, it's based on your capacity. It's based on your income and your money. If you make $10 million a year, what's wrong with having a $100,000 wedding, for example? There's nothing to criticize of that person. So I remember one mother, she's like, brother, I respectfully disagree with you. I'm like, okay. She's like, with $100,000, what you could have done with them is you could have done this, this, and that. Is she right? Yes, she's right. I'm not wrong. طبعا, you can do a lot. And may Allah help all those who are in need. Amir Rabbil Alameen. I would love to have $100,000 myself, right? So I asked her a question. She said it should have been a lot less than that. It should be a humble amount. I don't know, whatever, 15,000, 10,000. Would you not think someone else is sitting like, I still think that's a lot. Yes or no? Yeah. Whose brain am I going to use to judge? I want this brain to be the ultimate judge. Right? Who judges? So then I asked her. I said, did you have breakfast today? No, don't take it as an insult. And the sahi, wait, are you awake? Lala. Did you have breakfast today? She said, yes. We were in a major city in downtown, okay? So I said, if you don't mind, can you tell me how much was your bill for breakfast? I think she said about $25. Now, $25 for breakfast for one person, that's a lot, صح? In Dearborn, agreed, in general. So I would tell her, $25 for breakfast? 25, you know what you could have done? You know, in other countries, You know what, $5? Some people make $5 a whole month. So what's the point that you can afford $25? It's within your capacity. You're within reason of what you can handle. So it's fine. Sahullah. So they're telling Qarun, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Musa's teaching the Sahaba, Musa is teaching the people. You're well off, buy a mansion. There's nothing wrong with it. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Is that what you afford? Go for it, right? Nothing wrong with it. But don't go get me a loan to get your wedding put together. صح ولا لا? Now like, yeah, brother, alhamdulillah, you got me nervous. I was going to come to you during the break, you know, to stress on this point because some folks here going all out with their weddings. Okay, can I also help the other crowd? And don't be sometimes like myself sometimes or some other people that like when they're dreaming of a wedding when they were a little kid, I will do it at the masjid. And I'll get pizza with a halal pepperoni. Be within a reason. May Allah protect us and grant us wisdom and hikmah. Ya Rabbal Alameen. So, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Enjoy life. Eat well. Go on vacations. Everyone has a right, right? You take care of your body. صح? Take care of your body. Don't go to the other extreme of religiosity, which is one time it happened. Abdullah bin Amr bin al-As, radiallahu anhuma, he just is a newlywed. So his father, Amr bin al-As, comes to visit his son. What's his son's name? Abdullah. So Abdullah is being visited by his dad, Amr bin al-As. So when Amr al-As comes, the father. He comes to the house, knocks on the door. Who opens the door? His daughter-in-law, the wife of Abdullah. So he looked at her and she was not well presented. يعني, I don't know, maybe the hair is not taken care of, the clothing is not in the best shape. Allah Ta'ala, but it was something that he was shocked. Like usually newlyweds, like especially you take it next level. Like you sleep with makeup, you wake up with makeup, you know what I mean? May Allah protect us. Exaggeration, relax, okay? But he saw her not in that shape. So he said, is everything okay? She said, yeah. How is my son treating you? How is my son doing? Oh, your son? MashaAllah. All night, Allahu Akbar. All day, I'm fasting. Every day, wallah, Allahu Akila, every day. All night, Allahu Akbar. All day, fasting. Every day. So do you think the father-in-law told his daughter-in-law, say, Alhamdulillah, you have a husband like that? No, he was angry. Amr al-As was angry. And he went to yashtaki ila Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Said, ya Rasulullah, my son does this, does this. Yaqi, look at the complaints. Look at today. Now you go to the imam. Imam, my husband is 37. He's addicted to FIFA. At night, FIFA. In the morning, I'm with the boys. Watching the Lions, 1-10. Wala mish ta'arif, what's the record? Right? Forgive me. Forgive me, the Lions fans. Right? That's, subhanAllah, different. Both extremes. May Allah protect us, ya Rab. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he goes to Abdullah radiallahu anhu. He says, ya Abdullah, alam ukhbar, have I not heard that you pray all night and you fast every single day? Qala na'am. You know, he's like, you know, Rasulullah knows about me, bro. He knows my name, bro. So the Prophet says, fala taf'al, don't you ever do that again. What? Don't. He said, fast some days and break your fast other days. Pray a portion of the night and sleep a portion of the night. Your body has a right over you. Your eyes have a right over you. And very intelligently, he says, then your wife has a right over you. Allahu Akbar, beautiful. All this under, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Don't forget your share in this world. It's not something, the world is nasty, the world is ugly. طبعاً, there's that side, understand. But there's khair in this dunya, inshaAllah, that will get you. They don't contradict one another. Dunya and akhirah, there is a connection, and yes, there is a contradiction. But to the believer, they can connect it together. And Abdullah bin Amr bin al-As, may Allah be pleased by him and his dad and his wife, he obviously learned this lesson. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. طب, what's advice number four? Be good to others. وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. So what do we say? Qarun. Don't be obsessed about this life, right? Don't show off and brag. Are you guys with me? So then he had all this money. So don't use it like that. Okay, how should I use it? What's my priority? Use your money for the akhirah. That's your priority. Whatever you do, you want to study science, engineering, medical school. Have your niyyah akhirah. That's how you go. That's how you enroll in college or you apply for a job. Akhirah. We got that, inshallah. May Allah make us all remember this point. Then, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. When you get that paycheck, don't forget your share in this world. Enjoy. Yeah, you know what? You earned it. Fantastic. Number four, you enjoyed, you took care of yourself. Now take care of others. وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. And do good to people the way Allah did you good. Allah blessed you with so much money. Use that money to help out people in need. See the talent Allah has given you. The charity of knowledge is to teach it. The charity of wealth is to give it. The charity of status is to help people and intercede for them. When they're oppressed and they are weak, they have no voice, and you have a status, your charity is to use your status to give the voiceless some voice. Are you guys with me? May Allah bless you all. So see what you specialize in. So if you have something so special about you, and you do, inshallah, yalla, how will you use this to help other people? May Allah make us of people who help others. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. So yalla ya Qarun, what do you have? He has cash, he has money. Build schools, sponsor orphans, help widows, help people from different areas in the world. You have so much money, you can go this far. Renovate a masjid. Whatever the possibility you can go for. Just do it, ya Qarun. Can you make a promise with yourself, inshallah, that you will do something tonight with a blessing Allah has given you? At least plan it tonight, inshallah. Something Allah blessed you with. Actually, I'm going to give you 30 seconds to think. Whether you want to talk with someone else about it, sure. You're blessed with something. You're given something. What will you do with that blessing that can be pushed forward? And remember, never do you give except that you will gain more than what you gave. I had a rule of thumb. Never will you give except that you will gain more than what you gave. Just this week, I was speaking to one of my family members this week, and I told them I really, really want to learn a certain knowledge of Islam, a certain chapter. Not very well learned about it. I want to really master it. So I told that family member, I know how. If I go and teach it to others. Agreed? If you want to master a science, teach it to others. If you want to increase your wealth, give it to others. If you want Allah's mercy, show mercy to others. You want Allah to forgive you? Forgive others. Irhamu turhamu ighfiru yaghfir Allahu lakum. Ma naqasa malu 'abdin min sadaqa. Everything I said in English, I just said it through a hadith. So always keep this in mind. So yalla, 30 seconds. Think of something, a blessing Allah has given you. How will you use it? What will you do? How will you pass it on to others? Number 5. Did you guys notice? Don't do B. Don't do B. What's this one? Excellent. That's how you memorize. Sometimes the Quran try to put a, you know, like a diagram for it. La, if'al, la, if'al, la. Just a way to memorize it. Number 5. وَلَا تَبْغِي الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And don't spread corruption, ya Qarun. Quit what was happening before. Don't spread the corruption. If you don't want to take anything I told you, us giving you this advice, you don't want to listen to us, just don't make it worse. If you don't want to give people good, just don't give them harm. And some people, best giving is to not provide harm. May Allah protect us. I'm not telling you to clean the ground before you leave. I'm not telling you to pick up the trash. I'm not. I'm just saying don't put trash yourself. Very profound. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Allah does not like those who spread corruption. You have a problem with مثلا, smoking, وكذا. Not because you're so rich, you're going to open up stores about مشاعرف hookah and smoking and ruin other people's lives. If you're so much into this sin or this issue, don't go around and spreading it and just trying to make it legal, whatever the case is, because you're going through it. Don't spread corruption. خليها على نفسك. Minimum, minimum. Don't go beyond your limits. Please. And that's what some people do. May Allah protect us and forgive us. They're going down, but they don't want to go alone. They want to grab as many people as possible. Agreed? May Allah protect us. Ya Rabb al-Alameen. Inna Allah la yuhibbu al-mufsideen. Allah does not like those who corrupt. What will Qarun do? Profound advice. Powerful. What will he do? How will he react? Everybody in a way is on their toes. What will he say? Will he change? If Qarun changes, you know what happens to Bani Israel? You know when someone is so evil. You know how many people say, Wallah bro, if LeBron James became Muslim, Ya Allah. Right? If Cristiano Ronaldo becomes Muslim, Allahu Akbar, the most followed person on Instagram. Forget Ronaldo, forget him. I'm telling you, Qarun, the man who had so much money, required 10 around that number, strong people to carry the keys. He's about to make his decision. What will he do? What will he say? Will he change his way? We will know after a 5-7 minute break. I'm trying to make it rhyme. Okay? Inshallah. Have a wonderful break and come back, inshallah, for our last session of the year, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair.